Into section three, we're going to look at the muscles that make up the anterior body wall. Now, the first step in this dissection is to reflect the pectoralis major muscle. And the easiest way to do that is to find the inferior margin of the muscle and then run your hand medially. And as you're doing that, cutting off the muscle from the underlying ribs and from its attachment to the sternum and also to the clavicle. And this will allow you to then reflect the muscle in this manner. And you'll notice that you don't have to worry about destroying any of the nerves or the arteries to the vessels, because they're all going to be found on the underside of the muscle. Once you've reflected the pectoralis major from either side, you'll reveal the pectoralis minor. It's attached to the ribs on the anterior rib cage. You should cut along its margin of attachment and also reflect this muscle as you have the pectoralis major. Having done this, this will reveal basically the bony thorax, showing the ribs right here in the intercostal spaces, which are filled with the intercostal muscles. I just finished cutting the block of the intercostal muscles out from several of the ribs here, and I've also broken the ribs with a pair of pliers so I can remove a segment of them. And after removing a segment of the ribs, about a finger's breadth lateral to the margin of the sternum right here is a long blood vessel which is coursing from the subclavian down along the inner surface of the ribs. This is the internal thoracic artery. It's accompanied by the internal thoracic vein. As this artery courses down the underside of the thorax, it is sending slender branches to each of the intercostal spaces, so that arising from the internal thoracic artery are going to be an anterior intercostal artery, which will supply each intercostal space. The next step is to reflect the external and internal and transversus abdominis muscles. And the best way to do that is to initially start by finding the upper margin of the external oblique, which is right here. The fibers are oriented in this direction, coming towards the midline. And we're going to cut these fibers as we see them end in their tendons right here, from about here down to the level of the umbilicus. So I've inserted a pair of scissors on the undersurface of this muscle so that it will guide my cut as I come down. Now, I've just completed the incision of the external oblique all the way down to about the level of the umbilicus. We don't want you to go any further than that, because we have an important area down in here, the inguinal area, that we'll be studying later on. I have separated the external oblique from the internal oblique by doing a blunt dissection. There's some fine connective tissue, and it's very easy to separate the two once you've found the plane. Furthermore, I have identified the internal oblique by the direction of its fibers. Don't forget that the external oblique fibers came down in this direction. The fibers of the internal oblique are at right angles to that, so that they are coming in this direction. Likewise, I've also cut along this margin of the internal oblique. It's a very thin muscle, so don't cut very deep. And once again, I've done a blunt dissection beneath the internal oblique so that I can reflect it and expose the underlying transversus muscle down here, transversus abdominis muscle. Now, in the fine connective tissue between the second and the third layer, we find these nerves running here. These are intercostal nerves which have continued down onto the abdomen, and these are the nerves that are innervating these muscles. So you will see these appearing in a regular fashion, and so far I've uncovered two of them here, and we would expect to find another one down here. So those are the three layers of the abdomen that you should carefully reflect in this manner: external oblique, internal oblique, and finally the transversus. Okay. Now to complete the dissection, we're going to look at the rectus abdominis muscle, and it is found within a compartment which is made up of something called the rectus sheath, and a portion of the rectus sheath is made up of this thin connective tissue. It's really a tendon, and it's really contributed to by each of the muscles that we dissected just a minute ago. That is to say, as the external and the internal and the transversus abdominal muscles come towards the midline, the fibers stop, and their tendon is really a very thin, flat tendon. Well, that tendon, as they join together at the lateral margin of the rectus muscle, now splits to form a little pocket in which the rectus muscle lives. So we are now cutting the anterior margin of that rectus sheath, and we've done that down the midline of the rectus muscles on the one side. So this is the midline here. There's a rectus muscle over here, and then there will be another rectus muscle on the other side within its own rectus sheath. So that there's an anterior lamina or portion of the sheet, and then when we look behind the muscle, you see there's a posterior lamina. So this muscle really lives within an envelope within this connective tissue. So we've cut it along its external surface, and we have reflected it away from the rectus muscle. Now, the rectus muscle is really composed of several muscles which have come together secondarily. They're really separate muscles, and that's what gives rise to these tendinous inscriptions that you can see here. And in fact, these tendinous inscriptions are what we recognize as the so-called six-pack, because if this muscle were to hypertrophy, it gets large here and here and here. Since these muscles, since the rectus muscle is really made up of separate components, one would expect to find that there would be more than one nerve coming to this muscle. Now, we saw the nerves previously traveling between layers 2 and 3, coming around the body in this manner, so that the expectation is that those nerves would continue into the rectus muscle on its lateral margin. And, of course, that's why during surgery, you would not enter the abdomen by making a long incision along here, because you would cut each of these nerves and paralyze the rectus muscle. So that one way of entering the abdomen is actually to cut the anterior portion of the rectus sheath, reflect that, and then you take the muscle and you always push it towards its innervation. And then you would cut the posterior lamina, and then you would be able to get into the abdominal cavity, one of several approaches into the abdominal cavity. Now, the other feature about the rectus muscle is its blood supply. And just as we saw with the pectoralis major when we reflected it, the blood supply and the nerve supply are actually on the undersurface. So I've cut the rectus muscle here, and on either side, you can see that on the undersurface, you should dissect out, there's a fairly large size artery that runs within or along the undersurface of the rectus. Now, where do these arteries come from? The internal thoracic artery that we saw up here giving off the anterior intercostals continues on down below the margin of the rib cage and continues on the undersurface of the rectus muscle. It changes name. It's the same vessel, but it changes name, and it becomes known as the superior epigastric artery. Likewise, there is another artery which arises from the external iliac, that is the end of the aorta, and it arises and comes up on the undersurface of the inferior portion of the rectus muscle, and they meet somewhere in the middle. And the meeting of these muscles introduces the concept of anastomotic connections. That is to say, if you were a blood cell and you were traveling up in the inferior epigastric, it would be possible for you to continue your travel without even knowing it and transition into the superior epigastric artery and continue on up. So that overall, these vessels represent a site for collateral circulation. That is, it would be possible for the upper portion of the rectus to actually receive its blood from the lower stem, that is, the inferior epigastric.